Hi, good evening. I got a jacket along, but like Payal said, the AC is missing. So I had a whole intro planned, but I think you know who's coming. She's clearly one of the present iconoclasts. She's outspoken, she's bold. She claims she's not neither Indian nor a Maharashtrian. She's a world citizen, and she doesn't make plans. So somebody who hasn't made any plans, it's amazing how far she's got. Please welcome Radhika Apte.
Yeah, good evening. Thank you so much for having me, and in the future, I mean, in anticipation, listening to me.
So to start at the beginning, you're born in Tamil Nadu, aren't you, Radhika? So this is somewhere.
Yes.
So do
yes.
you speak the language?
No,
Tamil?
I don't. My parents do.
Okay.
I mean, they're Maharashtrians, but they were studying at Ida Scudder, CMC,
okay.
Bangalore.
Yeah.
So they were studying, and then they were working there for a brief period after. My dad's a neurosurgeon, my mom's an anesthetist. So I was born there.
So how did you end up in theater and films from neurosurgery and anesthesia?
So you're assuming that that's what is running in my blood. No, yeah, it doesn't work like that. I'm just joking.
Yeah, sure.
But I didn't like, I didn't want to be a doctor. For the longest time, I couldn't take an injection. I still go to my pediatrician, and I have to go to his clinic twice, once to just sort of make myself feel better, and then the second day I go to take injection. So recently I started taking injections on my own. I just met him last week, and he was so proud of me.
to see some of your work, especially the stuff you've done on Netflix, which we'll come to in a bit, the fact that you may be India's most obvious digital star, you know, you're the first one who's crested it. You've done films like Phobia and Ghoul, which are really scary, films, Radhika. So how did you process your way through those films?
Well, that is not scary, yeah?
Okay.
Because, if you're doing a film, you're wearing all the prosthetics, you're spending so much time in going through. I'm scared of injection.
Okay.
I'm not scared of ghosts.
So ghosts are all right for you?
Yeah, actually, I used to be scared of ghosts. I mean, to tell you very honestly, when my grandmother passed away, it was very close to me. And this is not a joke, this is just seriously telling you. When she passed away, somehow I stopped. I was very scared of ghosts, actually. I never saw one. But then I thought that now she's there. Now nothing can happen. Nothing can go wrong.
Oh, she's gone into the spirit world
she's
to take
care.
She's
only there now. If something comes, she'll protect me.
Okay.
So, but it's actually worked, huh? I mean, I know it sounds ridiculous, but it did work.
So there's another interesting facet about you. I read you were homeschooled, Radhika. That's amazing. So
Someone spread this about
me. Oh, that's not true?
That's not true.
Okay.
Everywhere I go these days, they ask me about my homeschooling, but I wasn't homeschooled. So basically, I went to the most conventional school for the first few years of my life. Then some of the parents, like including my parents, they came together and they thought that they did not like the schooling system. And they didn't like how competitive it was, how it sort of didn't mean anything. Students were just made to, ratta maro and learn, and then it really didn't add to any knowledge. So they decided to start a school. So they started a school.
Oh, right,
it was a proper official school, and I was in the first batch of that school. And
started a school for you. Let me get that right. They started
all
a school
of us,
for you?
All of us. Okay. And then, of course, we had lots of other students. So we were 25 students in our class, no divisions. And it was an experimental school, so a lot. Like to the seventh standard, we didn't have exams. And
so we were encouraged to be a free thinker, which is what makes
yes.
you a bold iconoclast today. You've got this reputation. Do you buy that reputation that you do unconventional roles, you take on messy subjects?
Not really.
Do you agree?
No, not really. But what that school did give me was the capacity to ask questions.
Excellent.
I think if you ask a question, you'd automatically make a different choice. What happens in our lives, I think we just don't ask questions. For example, when I got married 6 years ago, I think.
You better get that right. In case Benedict is watching.
Yeah. Oh, no. He's not. He's least bothered.
Okay.
We got married also for the visa, yeah. Is there anybody sitting here who I should be worried about? No. But listen, whoever's here, you guys have made it's difficult for people from different countries to get married and not married and have a relationship. It's so difficult for me to work in the UK. He's British. And if I tell you what the laws are, it's ridiculous. We've been together for 8 years. And he couldn't work here, so we realized that if we get married, he can then work here.
You know, I failed getting two marriages within India working, Radhika. So I can't even imagine what an international marriage works like.
It's
amazing.
It's a long-distance marriage.
Yeah, yeah. I can't work a marriage between Warsaw and Bandra. Forget about London.
Maybe that's
and
the problem.
Okay. So tell me about the other thing. 2015 was your big breakout year, as we all know. Earlier you had done small films like Hunter, Shore in the City, provocative roles, very interesting roles, especially Hunter, where, you know, that dialogue where he says Vasu and Chodhu, that is amazing to see you on screen. But then later you graduated to big films, almost mainstream cinema in a way, Padman, Kabil, you know. What was that journey and the difference like, Radhika, between the earlier films and the ones you did later?
Okay, I'll just join the earlier question, which I didn't answer, forgot. And then come to this. The reason why I spoke about my marriage was because when I was getting married, most of the people in the industry told me not to get married because they told me if you get married, then you're not going to get work. So I know a lot of people who are married and nobody knows they're married.
Yeah, that's true.
You know what I mean? So my point was that
you want to share some names in case you want to share some names?
Not really. Okay. So they might be like related or something, who knows? No, I'm kidding. But so the thing is, the question I wanted to ask myself at that time, that why if I get married, why will I stop getting work? And why would a man not stop getting work? It's because, you know, we have this notion in the society that women become less desirable if they're married. I find it extraordinarily offensive. And even women who, women start aging, there is a thing with desirability, right? And I find it, I get so angry with it. So I said, then why am I, if I hide my marriage or not get married, I'm actually
this
supporting that, right? So similarly, when you call my roles unconventional or bold or messy and all that, the reason why I don't believe that is because actually if you see the kind of roles I've done are very normal, yeah, or your and my lives are like that. I mean, you know, these are the people you meet out all of the place. Tell me who meets the other people from the mainstream cinema that you see, you know, dancing around. Either they are so sweet, always nice, or
they're fake. They're kind of fake, you know.
So yeah. I find that extraordinary.
In fact, you've touched upon a very big thread which one has been noticing over the last 20 years. The fact that no Indian actor, actress really would admit to being married through the 80s and 90s is a fact.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's also a difference in how women have gotten emancipated, Radhika, which is great, yeah? And I think you're at the forefront of that because I read about something. You're also part of a woman's sexual fantasy online site. I love that.
Yeah.
That's great.
It's so sad. No, this is what we call emancipation, that you can get married and work. I mean,
we are an old civilization. We'll take time.
I mean, come on, yeah. You're starting where? I'm asking myself different questions now.
I agree. Yeah. But it's Bollywood will take time to change.
Bollywood and us are the same thing.
I don't think so. I think it's a different microcosm they live in, a different kind of industry.
No. We like when Salman Khan romances with a 16-year-old. Our society does.
Okay.
And society will go watch something, and what society watches is will be made because it's not exclusive groups, yeah. It's the same people. In the sense.
So would you say we are regressive or we are hypocrites? What are we as a society?
We are both.
Both, okay.
Yeah. I think we are massively hypocritical as well. And who was I discussing this with just 2 days ago? I would of course not take the name, but somebody very mainstream, you know. I had such a great time talking to him because we were talking about how there are now roles for women and, you know, things have changed. And I was like, things have not changed. You know, nothing has changed. Because there was a time where Shabana Azmi, Smita Patil, then even Madhuri Dixit, Sridevi, all of them had tremendous roles in their careers, no?
But in a commercial format, largely in a commercial format.
No, they had some really, really great films also that they've done. And very, very, they were driven by the women. They had very meaty roles, all of them.
I think the differences in the distribution now, Radhika, when they were doing those films, the part of the 70s, the so-called art film, the ones you're referring
not
to.
Not just
art. They didn't get seen. Today you do a ghoul or a love story.
Sadma was seen. Sadma was commercial, but
no,
she
Sadma
had
was a mainstream Sridevi. Come
still,
on, completely commercial.
But I'm saying both spaces. No, I'm saying that a Smita Patel was also doing these smaller films, which probably
sure,
not
sure.
seen. She was also romancing with Amitabh Bachchan, which was very much seen and had
Correct.
A great part. So was Shabana Azmi and Sridevi and Madhuri Dixit was doing commercial films and they were running on her name. And I'm saying that today, again, we'll have probably the same or lesser numbers of women doing mainstream cinema or smaller films, but women-centric films have not changed or gone up in numbers or anything.
Okay.
It was there two decades ago also. It's now there, you know, it's there now also. And if you actually see the statistics, probably the same, yeah.
But hasn't the digital age given incredibly new opportunities when it
yes.
didn't exist, and especially for you?
It's now.
I remember Netflix came out with saying Radhika app hai.
For your
name.
Marketing.
Yeah.
Don't get sold by their marketing.
Yeah, of course it's marketing.
But
the world is marketing, Radhika. That's all it is.
I know, but somewhere
we
have to keep a realistic perspective. No,
do you manage to do that? Keep your feet on the ground in the midst of all this?
No, of course. Me Too movement happened. Everybody was like that. What is around? Nothing. You know, I had an incident last 2 weeks ago. And there was this young boy who showed a very controversial film of his at a screening which was quite prestigious. And somebody asked him, there were sex scenes in it where they were quite disturbing sex scenes.
Okay.
And she wanted to ask if he had taken consent from the women.
This is an Indian film you're talking about?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Can you name the film?
Not really right now because
cool.
it's quite
Fair
controversial.
Enough. Okay.
And the woman wanted to ask if they had taken consent from the women.
Yes.
In the film.
Yes, of course.
And the director would not answer this question.
That's crazy.
And of course. And I thought it was not acceptable. And the director kept insisting that I'm trying to make the audience feel so different things and make them go through that disturbance and I want them to go through all these things. A clever piece of art doesn't need you to pretend what you've done in your process. I can feel disturbed anyway if your film is good. You don't need to tell me that, oh, the woman wasn't raped, huh? Was raped or wasn't raped, I can't tell you. That is not going to make me disturbed. That's going to make me disturbed about you, not the film. So it was really agitating. But the people there, a lot of people there,
This is in Bombay screening?
Why are you going where it was? Look at this.
Trying to get a fix of what the film was. You're talking about an Indian film.
Whatever it was, my point is different. My point is the people in the auditorium who were making such a halla about Me Too movement last year had nothing really to contribute. That is my point. My point is marketing is there. If you actually see, I had a tiny part in Lust Stories, a tiny part in Sacred Games. And yes, Ghoul. It doesn't make me a Netflix queen. There are lots of people who have done much more work on Netflix than I have.
Yeah,
it's
but the
marketing.
Perception was that. And it worked to your advantage. So
Absolutely.
Why should you deny it? You should enjoy it, shouldn't
you?
No,
it's not about that. I'm saying that it's great to enjoy that, but it's also important to see the real picture. Because if I don't see the real picture in all these contexts, I'll say that Bollywood has changed. Now women have great parts. Arey, I don't have enough films to do.
Okay.
I have to be real. I mean, I go to my agents and they gave me a list last month of all these films are being made in Bollywood right now. So let's start talking to them. Most of them were men. And there were two or three films out of about 50 or 60 that had women as the lead. And the rest were, these days everybody would want to make biopics. So
yeah,
somebody's
it's
wife.
Yeah, the big season, yeah.
And that two are living people. How unbiased that's going to be. But, you know, and so this person's wife and that person's girlfriend. So I was like, okay, so we are exactly there. Not much has changed, yeah.
My God, okay.
I feel, say, yeah? I'm very cynical, but...
No, but you're in the midst of the industry, so if you're saying it, you must feel it, I guess.
I think so. See, there are this Kangana who's trying to do something, there's Deepika who's trying to do something, Anushka, Alia.
That's a lot of women, four women there, no?
I told you four women from last 2 decades also.
okay. So the numbers haven't increased?
No.
Okay. So, but when you talk about doing a subject like Hole, don't you consider yourself the star of the show, the series?
See, I barely got paid.
And Phobia too, actually. Phobia?
Again, for both the films, I barely got paid.
Ah,
they were
the money.
Made as really tiny budget films. I like them. I like Phobia a lot. I like Ghoul also, marginally. But But, oh my God, you know Patrick.
I do, yes. No, but you can speak about him.
I'm going to get screwed.
No, please tell us.
No, I know, he knows that too. But it started on a note and then a lot got sort of, anyway, that's not the point. They were made as small films, and when Netflix came in the beginning, you know, they were trying to get a lot of...
Yeah, Goon was supposed to be an individual film, I know that.
And it was stuck for 2 years, no?
Yes.
So they made us do a bigger sequence.
Yeah.
A lot of got lost in that.
But when you were speaking, two things stood out. One, you spoke about the bold scenes, that etc. That's the other thing, Radhika. When I Google your name, I get a sense of, you know, you've got a bold, sensuous image.
Huh.
Is that conscious or has that been inflicted on you, like the feeling that you are everywhere on Netflix? Is it a marketing thing again or is that something you're okay with?
Bold.
A bold, sensuous image. That's what...
Okay, I'll just come to that. But I'll just finish the earlier question. I was just trying to tell you that when Netflix came, they were taking these smaller projects.
Yes.
Now they are taking a lot of big projects. So now we have to wait and see if smaller films are going to be made with them and the other platforms or not. And I'm not saying it in a negative way. They might really do it, but I'm saying that it's a game.
Yeah, it's a toss-up. I agree. Because that was the entry level. That's how they were entering.
Now, bold, I think I'm associated with this word bold for two reasons. One, as you've earlier mentioned, the choices. Yeah. And you're right. They are unconventional in the...
Bollywood sense.
In the this thing.
Yeah.
But you know, Marathi, we have a saying that Vasrat Langdi Gai Shahani.
Okay.
Means, sometimes when I translate from Marathi, my English also goes for a toss. In the middle of calves, a cow who's missing a leg or a crippled cow is wiser.
Cool.
You know? So that doesn't mean...
Andho mein kana raja, that kind of thing?
Correct.
Okay.
So it's like that. Bold choice. You're not making anything path-breaking. So in that, if you make something a little this thing, somebody becomes very bold. And which is why I say I'm not that bold, because these subjects aren't really... they're not really shattering you. Or, like, you know, when you do it, they're not like, oh my God, this is really incredible. This is so challenging.
But describe a film which you would consider that incredibly challenging and shattering. Both in the Indian Hollywood context.
I'll just tell you something that I watched recently. I don't know if you've watched this series called Fleabag.
No.
Have you seen Killing Eve? Fleabag. Incredible, right? I was laughing and I was like, this is great, you know? Or even to have those kind of characters to make, you know, to actually have the courage to be flawed women. Somebody, I remember, I did Love Stories and I was told that... This is feminism from a male perspective. I said, not once in Love Stories have we spoken about how I should also be able to sleep around if men are sleeping around. Never. It's about a woman who's confused and completely misled and mistaken and making mistakes. It doesn't talk about gender. It doesn't talk about gender equality. It's about a woman who's flawed and completely, sorry for my language, but fucked up in her head. So if I show a man, it's fine. If I show a woman, why are you talking about feminism? There is not talking about gender.
Okay.
You know? So it's the same thing. Anyway, so the subject becomes bold. But the other thing, I think the bold I'm associated with is nudity. Because when you Google me, I don't know, I've not Googled myself recently. But there was a time when only nude clips used to come.
Yeah, they pop up still, yes.
I stopped Googling. I might as well see myself in a mirror. Why should I YouTube it? You know? So that's another reason why that word is associated with me. But I love to be naked. In the sense, what I'm trying to say is that I'm very comfortable with my body. Yeah, I mean, I don't see a problem. If you make a big deal out of it in your head, only then it becomes an issue. It is not a big deal for me. If there's a project which requires you to do a nude scene. I've grown up on world cinema. I've seen it and I've seen how beautifully people shoot it. You're not looking at somebody's nipple or butt. You're looking at them. You're looking at why they are nude at the moment. And I just don't look at it as a big deal. And I understand in our country especially and various other countries also, it's difficult to do that. But the first clip that had leaked was from a film called Clean Shaven.
Yeah, the Anurag film.
Anurag's film, right?
That was startling. That was quite amazing.
It's such a good film,
yeah. It's a fabulous film. I don't know how many people have seen that film.
Nobody's seen it. It's not released
here. Yes, of course. Yes.
And
it's part of a compendium of worldwide
anthology. We won at Tribeca also for that.
Yeah, yeah. I loved the Clean Shaven. Your story.
Yeah, yeah. It was absolutely fantastic. It was a film about pubic hair. And it was a film about a woman who doesn't know that other women actually wax or shave pubic hair. And then one day she finds out, and her life actually collapses because of that, you know, in a middle class family.
Yeah, it's worth seeing, really.
It's a very interesting subject. And for that, I had to do a nude scene, quite obviously. So I liked the subject so much that I thought I'll do it, and it was a foreign film, so I knew it'll be treated well, but of course not. It was post-production was in India.
Yeah, so that's where it leaked. Yeah, that's terrible. Leaked. Yeah, that's terrible, yeah. But the film was great.
It was really good.
Yeah. Also, you mentioned Lust Stories recently. I read somewhere that you'd also co-written Lust Stories, this film with Anurag.
I know, it's there, okay. But I haven't written a word of the film.
Okay.
But that is something you ask Anurag.
Okay, but he also says, I've read Anurag's quote saying,
I haven't written it. So basically, it's a long story, but I haven't written it.
We have time, I think.
No. Okay, in a nutshell, I had an idea that I had written about two millennial kids.
Right.
And he had liked that idea, and he wanted to make that. So he called me when I was in London saying, I have to play it. I said, I don't look 16 years old. I'm not going to play it. So I said, okay, I'll make it into a teacher boy. So I said, but this is not the story. So I gave it to somebody to write it. Then they wrote another script. And then when I went, he said, I don't have a script.
Which Anurag must have made into Bombay Velvet, I guess.
No. Then he took that script that somebody had written, and then on the day he put those monologues. So when I went on the first day, he was writing monologues. And then he gave it to me. So because he thought of sort of the idea from the script that I had written.
Right, the earlier idea.
He's written my name, but it was a different film altogether. So I have not written this film at all.
But what's your process of selecting a film or a project, Radhika? Is it the script? Is it your character? Is it the director? Or now that you've entered the big league, is it the producer that you know, or has it been changing over the last?
It changes. It changes from project to project,
yeah.
Really.
Okay. So give us a few examples.
If Anurag or Sriram or some other people that I'm very close to, when they call me, I don't even ask for the script. I just do it. Okay. Because I really trust them. And if something has to go wrong, in the sense if this film has to not work out, it's fine. I'm fine with that. And I know that they won't make me do something that I completely feel that it's not okay. We have that space to discuss things. But otherwise, I normally obviously look at my character and the script and how good it is, and the director, especially because I think that's the most important relationship on a set. There are times when I look at the banner because
Padman would be that. Look at the banner.
Actually, no. I love Balki.
Fair enough. Yes, of course. Yeah.
By the way, he's one of the most. He's a true feminist.
Yeah,
he's
and he has a very different sensibility, a very aesthetic sensibility.
No, he's such a great human being. Okay. I really love him. I did it for him basically. So of course I look at banners sometimes because you need commercial viability also. So Bazaar I did because of that. Because it's, you know, every time I go, even if I go like this to meet people, they go like, yeah, but I can't really visualize you as an urban girl. So I go like, okay, what do you want me to do for that? I don't know.
But you've done that in Padman and all that. No,
yeah, full, but yeah, they get very stuck. They go like, sorry.
Visualize nahi kar sakte, kya?
Arre, but I mean, anyway. So, nahi hota. So
you should probably tell them they shouldn't be directors of casting
agents. Typecasting happens. It happens. It's very difficult to get. And they think that I can't look glamorous. So when Nikhil was like, we'll do this. So we were like, okay, we need to do this to break the image. So we do need to take that call sometimes. Sometimes I do films for money.
This is Bazaar you're talking about? Bazaar?
No, for the commercial.
Commercial,
yeah. Bazaar, the Bazaar was commercial. The film. And Nikhil was like, you got to do something like this. And I completely agreed with him. So you need to have a balance also. To have some commercial viability, otherwise why would anybody put money on me? And sometimes I do work for money.
Okay. Has the money improved and bettered over the years?
Now the money's has improved, so I don't have to do films purely for money.
Excellent.
But earlier, so I've done films purely for money and they're very obvious.
Okay. Like, it's life choices we all make.
Of course. I'm not ashamed at all.
No, you shouldn't be. Also, you spoke about European cinema and Hollywood and all of them, how they treat women and the subjects. You've just you did The Wedding Guest with Michael Winterbottom. I confess I haven't seen it. I apologize for that. But what was
it released yet?
It hasn't released in India, right? Yeah, okay. So what was the process like working in a Hollywood film for you, Radhika, compared to your Bollywood experiences?
I mean, I wouldn't say Hollywood because I've done two small films. One is The Wedding Guest.
Wedding Guest.
And the other is called Liberté, which is...
That's the World War II drama?
Yeah, which is yet to release. But they're very tiny films.
And fair enough.
I've done quite a lot of work in Bollywood. So to compare... to say two films and then talk about Hollywood
no,
is
the
not
process.
Fair.
Was the process very different?
See, the process in every film is different.
Okay.
Because every director has their own process. The only two things that were starkly different, if I really have to compare these two versus the rest of the films, was A, everyone came on time.
Okay. Professionalism. Lovely. Wow.
And B, I got paid on time and I didn't have to ask.
Yeah. On this Netflix project, I realized, working with Americans and all, everybody's on time.
I'm being paid
completely.
On time.
It's startling. And India has no concept of
up.
Time. Yeah.
Yeah, true. I don't have to follow up.
On payments. Brilliant.
Payments.
Brilliant.
And people come on time. We pack up on time. It's like okay. It's great.
Okay. And since in this interview season, it's become a very popular question. Do you like mangoes?
I love mangoes.
Okay, and do you eat them aise karke ya wash basin ke upar se?
Every time I eat a mango, I spill it on my dress. Every time.
Okay.
Absolutely every time.
And what, you're a hapus or chausa or dushari?
Hapus or hapus. If amras is being made for me, like pyri, if they make the amras.
Oh, yeah, the
yeah,
liquid.
Then I'll have it. I won't make it, but otherwise I'll have hapus.
But are you the kind of person who cooks? Are you a cook? Or do you like kitchens?
I love cooking.
Okay.
Yeah.
And do you find it a stress buster? What do you do when you're stressed out, in fact? Is it music, mass massage, walking?
I have some bad habits
Netflix
also.
Netflix and chill, what?
No, but...
when you want a break, you want to just...
No, if I'm too stressed, I talk to friends or I'll read something, watch something, go for a run, have a glass of wine.
Are you a physically active person? Are you sporty? Were you sporty in school?
I was a dancer.
Yeah, of course. You've done dancing, yes.
So,
of course.
So I'm quite...
Even in London, you went...
Yes, I went to study dance.
Right.
We went from cooking to stress bus.
How do you work your stress busters out? Is it cooking, dance, music? Like, because the industry that you're part of is madly stressful and can go quite insane. So what are the choices you make? And you know, somebody like Deepika has spoken about the fact that how she was affected by depression, and she spoke beautifully about it and openly, which was great. You know, nobody would speak about such. So have you ever been subject to stress and depression? Have you been through such?
Of course, I've been depressed. In fact, for the last 3 years, I've been extraordinarily difficult. And I've been depressed. I've been dealing with... I have major anxiety issues. I have an anxiety disorder, if you want to name them. If you actually name something, everybody has something or the other, I've realized. So it's useless. But I do have major anxiety issues. And I've tried to deal with it with various methods. But... You know, my anxiety and my depression didn't come from work. It came from personal life. Recently I was talking to somebody about women doing a lot of surgeries, and somebody was saying that, no, but your industry is so stressful that people succumb to that stress. And I was like, are my brother also who's giving a 12th exam has stress. Stress is everywhere. You know, you have to make choices. That you have to make. And if you do make certain choices, stand by them. Don't just say that's because the industry is stressful. I mean, if you have an ambition and you are ready to do it by this way or that way, then that's your choice.
Brilliant. So would I be right in saying you're an optimist? Are you look forward to the positive, the glass half full?
No, actually, I'm trying to be a realist.
Okay.
Because actually, I'm a pessimist.
Realist in Bollywood, wow. Terrific.
No, I'm a pessimist. I always think of the worst. I always think that it's going to be a catastrophe. I always think that I'm going to be unemployed or I'm going to be unhappy, miserable. Worst will happen. So I'm trying to now sort of train myself. This is really out of the blue. Oh, but I have a big mouth. I find it very difficult to not... be secretive, and my PR agent is sitting here who's probably late to talk to me. But I tried a lot of therapy when I was depressed. I've tried everything.
Okay.
All kinds of therapy, hypnotherapy, all of that. Hypnotherapy is great, and medication sometimes, this and that. But recently I found out cognitive behavioral therapy.
All right.
I just want to tell you that that's brilliant. So if anybody wants to try that, please try that. Because I used to go to therapy, and you know, I've changed a lot of therapists because you need to find the right person for yourself, right? No, it really needs to match. I remember this one person who was really brilliant and very massive, and I'd heard great stories about her, and it was a Skype session with her.
Right.
But she was always doing this, so I just couldn't talk to her. You know, so it depends on who you get along with also. So I had a psychiatrist who was helping with my, I have a little bit of insomnia, now I'm better. But he was helping me, and then hypnotherapy was going on, and then sort of they both, they coincided, you know. And I was like, great. So I do have a few answers about what things I'm confused about and everything. But still, I would come home and get stuck in the same circle. I'm not saying I'm out of it, but that's what happens, right? You feel good and you come home and then you get back into the whole thing and you can't break it. Cognitive behavioral therapy teaches you how to break that. And that's why I am very excited about it, as you can
see. So it's obviously been working for you.
I've just started 2 months ago.
Okay.
And it's first time it's very hopeful. So I just want to tell you that it's a new thing, I think, and new thing isn't relatively new. Yes. So for example, that's a whole theory I can't get into because it's a whole theory and they have certain books they give you to read to understand certain patterns and this and that. But for my anxiety, they've given me a couple of forms. They're called thought record forms. And every time I get very anxious, I have to fill them. So it's a thought record, number one, number two. And the questions are so brilliant, they break down your anxiety into very fundamental questions and analysis. And it doesn't judge anything, but it breaks down. And then you realize a pattern in your anxiety. And you'll realize how you're actually changing while you're writing that also. So it's really brilliant because it's a tool to actually understand the pattern and break it. I'm giving you one very simple example. But these are the things you need to do at home because I tried meditation, running, yoga,
didn't work.
That didn't help me. But anyway.
And Sriram Raghavan, you've done 2 films with him now, Badlapur and Radhun, and he's one of our best directors by far. What was the experience working with him? Do you give yourself to the director, Radhika, or are you more of a Messner kind of a, you pull it up?
I like to surrender.
Okay.
I absolutely surrender 100%. Unless the director, you know from the day one that, you know.
He's not worth surrendering to at
all. No.
Yeah.
Then you do what you want to do. But mostly I love to surrender. I think that's where you get the inspiration
from. So Anurag, Sriram would all be in that.
100%.
Hunter, I've forgotten his name, Harshvardhan, he'd 100%. Be in that category. Okay.
Now with Sriram, you know, the thing is he changes his script a little bit every day and he'll improvise. And
right till the edit. Yeah, right till the edit.
Oh, we shot over the year. He keeps...
And Andhadhun had like 2 different endings for people who don't know, and Fox and Sriram fought over it endlessly before he insisted on his own ending.
So we shot the first year and then he edited it and then he wanted to change a few things. So we shot exactly after 1 year again. But like for example, my character was very tiny. It was not a part of the plot really. And he wanted somebody, he didn't get anybody at the last minute, so I was a part of the film. But you know, even if it's a small part, even in the day, all we're shooting is a montage of us crossing the street or something tiny. He gets so excited about it because he wants to make a moment out of that or he wants to bring something in it. And I find that very inspiring.
Do you follow politics? Did you vote?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
You did?
But
are you a political person? Are you?
I am, but I really want to listen to your talk. But
I think you'll be in the flight by the time Chaturmay comes on.
No.
Okay.
Anyway.
But did you follow, are you a political person?
I follow a little bit. My family follows so much that I've sort of become a bit like this about it. But I follow.
I follow
enough to decide whom to vote.
And do social issues concern you? Or are you in your own world of films and that's all that?
What social issues?
I mean, what's happening in the country, the Prime Minister and...
Political
issues and social issues. Do they concern you? Me Too and stuff? There was a Men Too that started like a month and a half, 2 months back. Karan Oberoi, a TV actor, got arrested. And Pooja Bedi and some other friends of them. They started a Men Too in support of men who may be falsely implicated. Do you think there is space for Men Too in India, in our society? Is there a...
Do we have time? Because I'd love to talk about it for 5 minutes. Okay. No, because the bell rang. No,
okay. Yeah.
You know, I had a panel discussion yesterday. And there was incredible women, and they were talking, and we were talking about how, what are men doing? And you know, all that. And I get a bit like this about it, because it's not an anti-man campaign, you know? The way women are, see, I personally feel, and I'm too privileged to speak, to be honest with you.
Because, I think all of us in this room
too privileged to talk about these things, but not too less also, in the sense we also go through a lot of things and we
Surely.
Need to fight for our rights, and definitely so. But I personally, with my limited knowledge, please accept that, because I don't claim to be some informed person. I think the major issue is awareness.
Okay.
You know, women don't know it's their right. Women don't know that this is not okay. That is the main issue. A woman doesn't know that my husband should not beat me up, for example. Or this is domestic violence, or this is rape. Or he shouldn't be holding me like this right now. Or he shouldn't be knocking at my door in the middle of the night. Or he shouldn't be sending me a text like this, whatever it is. We don't know this. We are not aware. That, I think, is a major problem. And secondly, it's not just about women and them being conditioned. It's about men being conditioned.
Well said.
I think superiority complex also is very sad, yeah. I mean, you know, I look at men who think they are somebody and I feel very bad for them. You know? No, I do. Because, no, I remember I had broken up with a boyfriend many years ago. And I remember telling somebody, I said, will he ever regret? Something had happened, not breaking up with me, I don't think he regretted that, but will he ever, something had happened, I said, I do regret things in my life, but looking at him, I feel, will he regret? And he did, he was a sweetheart. But this man told me something, regret is a, we'll feel fortunate that you have experienced this feeling of regret. Feel fortunate that you have the
capacity
to actually feel that, because every human being is going to make mistakes. Every human being is going to go through that. These superiority complexes, no, of not being able to be exposed to certain emotions that make you enrich you or make you learn, I feel bad. And I think both men and women need to be conditioned.
Excellent.
You know,
because men certainly, yes.
So many books I was just reading to my niece in the UK, and is about, I'm not a girl, I'm not going to cry, something in the book. And I was like, still today we are writing this. A boy should be able to say that I can cry. This is also sad. And it's a part of this, you know. Because yesterday there was some debate about women are not just emotional, they are also practical. So you're basically saying emotional is bad and practical is good.
No, I think none of these binaries really work. Yeah, we can't. You
so
can't do that.
I'm in support of both, because if you talk about abuse, my God, the boys that go through abuse is
it's quite a bit. I think so, I'm getting your hints. Okay. So last question before we go: what are your future projects? Quickly, I know about Raat Akeli Hai, which you're doing with Hani. What else with Nawaz?
Actually,
just tell us.
Yeah, okay. So I finished a film, Raat Akeli Hai. I have two films releasing. I have
which ones? Please tell.
The Wedding Guest and Liberty.
Yes.
There are 3-4 projects I'm about to sign, but I'll...
Okay, you don't want to talk
about
them.
I'll talk about them when I've signed them. But I'm taking a 3-month break.
Brilliant. Starting when?
Starting from June. So June, July, August.
I'm going
to Galapagos to dive. July, I'm going for a pottery course. And
amazing.
August, I'm going for a road trip.
Amazing.
I'm on a holiday. No,
I think with that, we'll wrap it up. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Radhika
Thank
Apte.
You so much.
Thank you so much.